develop a point of view, and then everything else will come after. Like, then you can wrap your point of view around anything that you're doing. If you're just learning a craft, you get really good, say, at drawing, or you get really good at painting or whatever, and then, I mean, that's all you're going to do. But if you develop your eye in the way that you see and your point of view, it can bend around any single medium or anything that you're doing.
Hey everyone, welcome to Artist Decoded. This is your host Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 76 of the podcast. And in this episode, I get the opportunity to talk to my friend, visual artist, Jesse Draxler. And he currently has an exhibit up at Booth Gallery in New York City, and it's open till August 12th. The exhibit is called Tire Fire, so definitely go check that out. I really like this conversation with Jesse, because we started talking about the idea of developing a point of view as an artist. And I think when you first start exploring your artwork, you're trying to develop yourself technically and figuring out how to do things. But eventually that how approach becomes a why approach, and you start questioning why and the intention of why you're doing things. And it's interesting because I feel like once you start understanding why you start doing things, then you start naturally understanding and being conscious of your personal point of view. So it was really good to talk to Jesse about this, because this is some things that have been going on in my mind recently in terms of my own personal art practice and the reasons why I'm doing everything. I hope you get a lot out of this episode. I really enjoyed talking to Jesse and having a conversation with him. He's a really great person and an amazing visual artist that I have a lot of respect for. So here it is, episode number 76 with my friend, Jesse Draxler. We can just talk about whatever, man. I mean, I guess we're here to talk about your show.
I guess, yeah. Coming up. Yeah. I remember last time that we did a podcast together, I was telling you that I'm not really good at talking unprompted or whatever. So, like, the questions leading questions are always appreciated.
Oh, of course. Yeah. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So, however we want to start off, man.
Yeah. Well, okay. So, why don't you tell us about the show first, and maybe some of the ideas surrounding it?
Sure. So the show is at Booth Gallery. Again, that's where I had my last solo show.
Mm-hmm. When is it?
The show opens July 8th and runs until August 12th. So it's a good run.
Yeah.
And it came about just with Casey Gleghern, who's the director there at Booth Gallery. Through working over the years, me and him have become, pretty close friends. And so I think my relationship with the gallery is a little bit more casual than a lot of people have with their galleries or the people they show with. Mm-hmm. So it was around Christmas time that he hit me up and he said that he had an opening where nobody was showing in his schedule for Booth Gallery and asked if I would be interested. And I don't remember exactly how it all went down, but I think at first I was a little apprehensive if I wanted to do another show, but then he brought up the idea of doing it as an all drawing or painting show where it's like no collage, which is what I normally do, or whatever you want to say. Like no mixed media would be actually just drawings or just paintings. And that sparked my interest then. So once I started working on the pieces for the show, I decided to do just all drawings. And yeah, that was kind of it. And I just drew. There wasn't any real ideas behind what I was drawing. It was more about the process of drawing itself. I mean, I was drawing mostly portraits, and it's similar to like my collage work, like the same kind of subject matter that I'm interested in all my other work. But it wasn't about that really. I wasn't trying to load the imagery with meaning. It was more about the process will be the meaning, and what I go through and discover along the way was more about it. And through doing that, it became almost like this therapeutic process of like going back in time to like my childhood and stuff, because I used to draw all the time, like that's how I started, was with drawing. I would draw comic books and cars and trucks because my dad was a mechanic and shit like that. So that's what I found myself drawing again. And then I started to like feel some of the feelings from back then, and then like adolescence and all that, going through time. And it became this whole like
surreal
experience. Yeah, it was like, I mean, I mean, a lot of those feelings and emotions from youth came back and everything, and I struggled through parts, and it was just a really weird process that just came about really naturally. Of it was like a regressive progress or process, like emotionally, but then it kind of like catapulted forward where I was like, now I kind of like work through them somehow through the drawings. I was working through all that because, I mean, it's been a long time since I actually had a drawing practice. Like, I've always kept a sketchbook, but I never like sat down and just focused on drawing for months on end. I haven't done that since, I don't know, like I was 20 years old.
So you kind of force yourself to, to draw.
Yeah. It was just a lot of drawing. Too much almost. Like, I killed it at the end. Like, I was like, I got to a point where I just got so sick of it and so over it that it just had to be like this. It was a burnout at the end. I was burnt out completely. Like, I got to a point where I kept on like, okay, draw more. And then at one point, it was just like, I can't even, like, I'm disgusted by this. Like, I have to stop.
Yeah.
And that was the end of it, which was kind of a weird way to end the process on this almost like negative note. But now looking back, it's very positive.
So generally in your work, it's like really compositionally strong. At least that's the way I look at it. Like, everything has like a an interesting like Jesse Draxler flow to it.
Yeah, sure.
How does that change with the drawing? Because you're not, it's not like you're composing it. Mm-hmm. You're more so, I mean, you're more so coming with the idea as you draw, right?
Yeah,
so,
pretty much. Yeah. I mean, I would draw from photo reference to start out. Even though it never, nothing ever looked like what I was drawing from, but it was like something to start with. But that was a really big hurdle to get over at the beginning, trying to figure out how to do that. Yeah, how to make these drawings compare to my other work, but not really compare, but stand up with my other work, if that makes sense. And I had a really hard time at first. I think at first I was trying to draw in certain ways that was like how I do my mixed media work and stuff. And it just, it was frustrating for a while until I just kind of gave up completely and didn't care anymore. And it was all about the process. And it was just like throwing charcoal at paper and messing my hands around in it and shit like that. So the process was really different. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. So my process when doing mixed media work is that I'm usually starting with an already existing image or something like that, you know, like be it a photograph or whatever it is. And then I manipulate that. Like, I act as like a, almost like a designer or something, you know, where I'm manipulating something that already exists. And then that way I'm like putting my hand on it or putting my mark on it. Yeah. That's what I do, is that I'm a changer. Not like a creator. I'm a manipulator.
But that's that whole thing like we were talking about before about, I mean, I even titled the episode at Creation Through Destruction.
Yeah.
And even like sitting in this room, I know like people can't visualize this room. I mean, I guess until we put a photo out there into the world. But, you know, I mean, even like seeing like a destroyed building or a destroyed like artifact or something, there's something that you like about, I mean, even with like, you like Richard Prince's work, right?
Yeah.
A lot.
Yeah. Right?
And it kind of like challenges the idea of what art is.
Yeah, definitely. I think I found a very comfortable place with doing my mixed media work where I felt very comfortable with taking something that already exists and then fucking it up. I mean, you know, manipulating and doing whatever, which you could call, you know, a form of destruction. Any, you know, it started as one thing, you're changing it, you're destroying the thing that it was. So, I mean, it is creation through destruction. And with drawing, you start with a blank piece of paper, and it's a very different way to start a process. And yeah, that was very difficult for me at first. Yeah, that's why when I first started out with the drawings, I was trying to make it somehow relate to my other work, and I quickly gave that up in lieu of just like going wild on the paper, you know, like just taking shit and throwing it at it and just using my hands and pushing the shit around and whatever and seeing what I saw in it. It's kind of how I paint too, you know. I do paintings where I only use my, it's all finger paintings, all those paintings you see on my Instagram and shit. It's all just finger painting where I just throw some ink down on the paper and then like smudge it around and then let it dry for a while and look at it and whatever, you know.
There's something very organic and somewhat Neanderthal, aboriginal.
Yeah, primitive. Kind of definitely. Primitive it's a primitive process. I think of that all the time, that like primal, you know, the primal is a good word. Like, I like the idea of like primal nature and shit like that. And So I wanted, yeah, that definitely informed how I started with the drawings then, like how I paint. It was just different. I had to find like, even had to find different materials where I could manipulate it in that way. Like I never had used powdered charcoal before, but I was like, powdered charcoal has got to be the closest thing to like a liquid form that I can like spread around with my fingers and do that kind of shit with. So I started using that and just getting as messy as possible. And then it was kind of reductive after that, where I found processes within that process as I started to work, and then I could kind of replicate some of those processes. But
overall, that's probably why at the end you were burnt out.
Yeah, absolutely. It's
because you're just trying to like pump out work.
I was. And also I was burnt out at the end too, because it's like I didn't care that much about what I was drawing. It was the processes, and I kind of just felt like I got to an end where it started really, really messy and primal, primitive, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it felt like it just got tighter as it went. And it got to this tight point where it was like, I don't care to render something perfectly. I don't care to try to load an imagery with meaningful objects and shit. Like, I don't give a fuck about any of that stuff. Mm-hmm. So once it got that tight where it was like I was rendering shit, I didn't care anymore. I was completely over it. And then trying to go back to a messier process is, it's almost impossible, you know, to work backwards like that.
Yeah.
So that was then. Yeah, I was just like, all right, I'm done. I'm over it. I remember at the end I had a day. So this other, the other side of the show is that there will be this big installation, like really big installation where it's like 53 sheets of 22 by 30 paper, like hung on the wall, like in a grid. And those are all the sheets of paper that I painted black that I had drawn on, decided I didn't like, and then I would paint them black. And like, so I'm going to show all those. But there was a day near the end, it was like, it might have been the last day, but I worked for 14 hours straight. Like it was manic in a way where I didn't even realize that that much time had gone by, or I didn't eat or anything. It was just like 14 hours literally straight.
Yeah.
And I made all these pieces. And then at the end of it, it was like 9 or 10 at night by the time I was done. And I'm up at like 6 in the morning, 7 in the morning working already. And at the end of that, I painted every single thing I made in that 14 hours black. Just every single thing. And yeah, at that point, I realized like you got to stop. That was absolute insanity that you worked for 14 hours and destroyed every single thing you made. So, yeah.
I feel like just from viewing the drawings that you've done, and I don't mean to like compare you to another artist, but I feel like you would really like Susan Rothenberg.
I'm not familiar.
I'm just going to bring her up.
Yeah, sure. Do it. It was really interesting that through the process, I realized that I didn't feel I had control hardly at all. There were days I just couldn't draw whatsoever, where it was like I started drawing and a half an hour later I was like, yeah, I can't. I just cannot make my hands do this. And then there were days where it just flowed and it was amazing. And then there were days where I was drawing this one way, and then the next time I drew, it would be a completely different way of drawing, like both technically and how it looked, you know? And it was just super weird to me. Like I felt like I had no control, that I was the idea of like containing multitudes, like you have many personalities or you're many people in one, kept on coming to mind, because I was like, every time I drew, I felt like I was drawing from a different person, from a different point of view, with a different style. It was really weird. It was really strange.
Have you ever had that experience through other forms?
Through other
of
mediums?
Art?
Through no, other not mediums? Really. I haven't. It was super weird. It was, and that's where it felt like going back in time and like going through the different things that I enjoyed as a kid and stuff. And I could tell, like, I was, at the times I was reading more comic books. I was drawing in a more comic style, like that sort of imagery, and even like the positioning of the people and stuff, and the overall style was more comic book style. And then I went through a period where I was looking at a lot of like Renaissance art, and then I was drawing more in those styles, and went through a period where I was looking at a lot of Egon Schiele. I don't know how to ever.
I think it's Egon Schiele.
Yeah, where I was looking at his stuff, and then I was drawing, you know, like him, and it was just like I felt like I didn't have control over how I even worked.
But I feel like, I mean, just thinking about that, I mean, I do believe in these sort of dualities of life, but also like, you know, that we are a multitude of an amalgamation of different processes and different ideas, and
absolutely,
yeah, and I feel like the more that we hone into that and try to understand that and dissect that, the more that we can be happy with
absolutely
whether our artwork or just ourselves.
Just in general, I mean, that's the idea of the ego being like a misstep an evolution almost, where it's not a misstep in evolution, but it's like it's embraced to a dangerous, it got to a dangerous place where everybody's just this ego and it's so singular. Like people are proud of the niche that in the world that they carved out for themselves. They're like, this is me, this is how I am, this is what I do, this is it. I'm me, this is, and
yeah,
it's just the wrong way to think, you know, like, you know, nobody's just this one static thing. You're constantly changing, you know, constantly evolving. Personally, one day I wake up and I feel like one person, the next day I wake up and I feel completely different.
Yeah.
To expect it to always just be the same and that you're this one thing, it seems to be, you know, that's harmful. It really, it limits you. You're limiting yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, you're limiting yourself through the consistency of the idea of what you think you are instead of allowing yourself to exist.
And it's not even that it's accepted. It's like championed now, you know, this idea of individuality, you know, like you're this one thing. It's this thing to be proud of or something. Mm-hmm. And it's completely backwards.
Yeah.
You know, I think at least.
But I think that has to do with the commodity. I mean, if we're talking about artwork specifically or art, that has to do with the commodification, the commercialization of certain art forms. But I mean, also people allow themselves to be pigeonholed into that scenario as well.
Absolutely.
I brought this up actually on the Gems episode.
Oh, really?
We were talking about the difference between, I just use these two examples because I feel like they're counter examples of each other. So I use Motley Crue as an example of like, just like, I don't know, like a reductive art form of art. If you want to consider Motley Crue art is a whole nother
thing. I'll go with you here.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then Neil Young, right? Because Neil Young has been through so many different phases of Neil Young, but it seems so organically processed.
Absolutely.
You know, as opposed to something that is a caricature or like something like that was a past self, but you know, now they're like 50-year-old men, like looking ridiculous and like,
yeah, totally. Absolutely. I think that happens in art, definitely, like visual art too, where people become pigeonholed by what is selling or like what they think their fans or the people that like their work want. You know, they start thinking about those things instead of like what they want to do. Mm-hmm. You see it all the time.
Yeah.
I at least it seems like you see it all the time. Like I get so, I'm constantly following and unfollowing artists on Instagram. I'm sure people know this and get upset about it when I'm unfollowing them, but I just get burnt out. It's like, this looks exactly like what you were doing a year ago. That's not interesting to me.
I've been trying to, I mean, just talking about like photography, because I've been doing it for so long. I've been trying to think to myself, like, what do I feel like doing now?
Yeah. You know?
What do I feel like doing today? And sometimes I could be, it can be somewhat confusing and challenging, but it can also be very natural and fluid.
As long as you don't put pressure on it.
Yeah.
You know, you can't put pressure on it, but it's also somewhat of a luxury if people need to pay the bills, you know, and they need to make, you know, can't just go changing up your shit all the time. And then you also need the time to be able to explore and play around and experiment and see where you're going to go. And so I understand both sides, but doesn't mean I got to pay attention to it. But you know, and going hand in hand with that idea, and you asked if I've experienced that feeling of constantly changing or whatever styles in any other medium, and I said I didn't, but the thing is that I work in so many different mediums that those are the way that I change up. I have a rotation that I've noticed. I mean, it's not the same rotation every time, but I've definitely noticed that I'll collage for a certain amount of time and I'll completely be over it at the end of doing it, at the end of that period of time. And then it's not like I can just, or I want to stop just doing art. It's like, I just want to do something else. And then I'll paint for, you know, a month or two, and then I'll be burnt out on that. And at the end of each time when I'm burnt out, it almost feels like I never want to do that again. But then you do the next thing and then you realize, or you learn something from the next process that you bring to the next process. So I learn things collaging, and then I bring it to the painting, and then I paint for a while, and then I draw after the painting. And then after the drawing, I want to paint some large scale panels or do some murals or something. And then I get sick of that and I go back to small scale collaging, or I go back to painting, or I go back to drawing. So it is kind of that constantly changing of styles, but just not within one medium. It's the processes that change. Yeah.
But then going back to that idea of you know, being able to like follow yourself as an artist and organically like flow with what you want to do. How do you find the balance between that and like the commercials or like, you know what I mean?
Because
you do shoot or not shoot, but you do do things for like, you know, different clients and stuff still, right?
Yeah, I do a good amount of commercial work.
Yeah.
How I see it is that a lot of artists or people that call themselves artists develop a craft and they call it art. I don't do that. It was more of like develop a point of view and then everything else will come after. Like then you can wrap your point of view around anything that you're doing. If you're just learning a craft, you get really good, say, at drawing or you get really good at painting or whatever. And then, I mean, that's all you're going to do. But if you develop your eye and the way that you see and your point of view, it can bend around any single medium or anything that you're doing. Mm-hmm. You know, take Instagram, for example. Now there's the video aspect with stories, which I really got into. I never was into video before.
Yeah, no, I noticed that it's very really a singular point of view.
It's very,
from you.
Yeah. So people can look at those stories and probably be able, like, if you didn't tell them whose story that was or whatever, they'd probably be able to tell you it's mine still, even though that's a video and this is a painting and that's a collage and this is a drawing. But people should still be able to tell they're all by the same person. And I think that's where it comes in, like, developing your point of view becomes so much more important than perfecting technical skills.
Exactly.
You know, somebody can be the best renderer in the world and draw, like, photorealistic drawings. Who cares?
Yeah.
Like, I don't, you know, I'm more interested in the point of view and let's see that person that has perfected that, wrap that aesthetic around their videos. And you come across it all the time, again, on Instagram as an example, where you follow an artist and you see all their amazing work, but then you see like a photograph they took or you see a video that they did and it just it looks like anybody else's or it looks like they're not an artist at all or something. And I guess to me, that never made any sense. But that's how I definitely keep it all wrapped up together because it's all within this singular point of view.
Yeah. Well, I think that's also, I mean, speaking about the educational structure of anything that we do, like from in school, and there's a structure to it, right?
Absolutely.
But there's no real classes aside from maybe like philosophy or psychology maybe that makes you try to understand the nuances of like of thought patterns and your thought process.
Absolutely.
And like trying to connect the things, the disparate elements of life and then put it all together.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But also it doesn't, I think sometimes education is too reliant on following a system as opposed to thinking for yourself, you know, and then that transitions into if you're, when you're an artist, you know, doing things from a technical point of view, as opposed to like an exploratory self-discovery point of view, which is why I like a lot of artists like Patrick Graham, because he, in the beginning, I don't know, are you familiar with Patrick Graham?
I've probably seen his work, but not by name.
So he came from that, he was a prodigy painter, and he, like, I think at the age of 15, he was in college and did like really amazing like renderings of like beautiful classic renderings, oil paintings. Right?
At what age?
Like 15 or 16. Wow. And then his gallerist actually explained this to me a bit, but he kind of went into this downward spiral, but then his artwork is so fascinating now, you know, and it seems like it from a very singular point of view, you know? And that's also why I brought Susan Rothenberg up, because it's like technically not proficient. It looks like scribbles and shit. Like it's a horse, but it's like a scribble, like with charcoal.
Yeah. I love that kind of shit.
It's just like, it seems like very chaotic, but at the same time, there's so much soul to it.
Yeah.
And it's crazy how like there's, you can just tell like some people just have so much soul in their piece.
Yeah.
And then others, it just seems like a rendering, right? Or just seems like...
Exactly. Right? And then those feel really, really stiff to me. Like when I see perfectly rendered stuff, the first thing I think is, wow, like that person, you know, is technically proficient, is amazing, you know, that's pretty incredible. What a great feat. But then the second thing I think is I'm bored as shit. Like if I wanted to look at something that was rendered perfectly, I'll just look at a photograph. And that's where I think that's more of like a craft or, you know... like a trade. It's like learning a trade. It's like learning welding really well or something.
Yeah.
You know, art, I think, is more in vision. It's more in a point of view, in developing that point of view. And art takes place in the brain for me, like the way I see it, as much as it does anywhere else, you know. Or like a great example of that kind of thing or whatever is Chris Burden. you know, Chris Burden, right? Mm-hmm. I just watched that documentary. Have you watched that documentary? There's a new documentary.
I haven't seen it.
Came out recently. It's really good. It's really good. But yeah, there was a part where I guess after he graduated college, he would just like sit in a room on a chair like all day and smoke pot and think. That's all he would do, is just sit there and think about art and question what art was.
Yeah.
And I think in that documentary, they talk about how he kind of like boiled it down to that art was action and shit like that. Like art was idea, art was action. You know, it was kind of almost anything but, you know, a painting on the wall. Mm-hmm. And that resonates with me. I think I relate more to like that kind of artist than I do other drawers or painters or collage artists even, you know, like. Yeah. I relate to that kind of art more than I do these other kinds of art. And that's why what you were saying about, what was her name? The scribble horse?
Susan Rothenberg.
Susan Rothenberg, yeah. That kind of thing where it's just like a scribble. I'm really into that kind of stuff too, where it's just scribbling, it's just gestures, you know. That's why I like using my hands so much too. It's like you can't even control it to that perfect of a way, or that technical perfection with just using your hands. But when you do work so fast and it is a scribble or it is just a gesture, those things are records of motion. You know, that's like a record of like a really quick motion. Mm-hmm. And in that way, it's like a record just of that moment in time as well. Whereas, so there's energy in it, you know, you're putting the energy into it. Whereas if you're just like rendering something perfect and it's taking forever, it just loses it for me. I don't know. It's not that record of time. It's not that energy. It's not, you know, it's not that. So
yeah, no, I agree. I want to show you her work now, if I can just find it, just so that we have a point of reference.
There's a artist on Instagram, like he's one of my favorite artists on Instagram that I follow, and I can't remember exactly. It's like, I think he's French, like a Luc Pierre or something like that. But he does a drawing a day that are just of like feelings, and all of it is just like abstract scribbling, and it looks like, you know, a child could have done it, but it looks like a really. It's amazing. I they're my favorite.
Yeah.
That kind of shit's,
I think,
my favorite.
Yeah, I think the art world wants to call stuff like that naive work.
Ignorant art.
Or whatever. Yeah. But I mean, here, check it out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I love this stuff. That horse is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for sure, man. Yeah, this is great.
Yeah. I forget which museum that I went to, and I saw, it was either one of the horses or, it was one of the charcoal pieces, and I was like, what the fuck is that? And then I don't know. It was just so fascinating because, you know, from an outsider's point of view, you might think like, oh, a child could do that. Or,
well, you could say that about like, go to LACMA and look at Franz Klein or something, you know, like,
yeah, that's true.
But that's like my favorite shit there.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah,
I'm always drawn to that kind of work over, I'll look at a technical piece, but I'm so bored with it. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. I hope I'm not offending anybody out there.
No. I mean, it's just a personal, no, I mean, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. I'm not personally drawn to like those perfect renderings of things, or I'm personally not even drawn to classical artworks.
It took me a long time. It took me a long time to give a shit about art history even. When I first learned about art history and stuff, I didn't care at all.
Yeah.
Now, I still don't care about the history that much, but I like going to museums and looking at Renaissance paintings and stuff now. I enjoy that. I see things in it, you know.
Yeah.
Compositions and positioning of the bodies and stuff like that I find interesting and useful. But yeah, I still don't care about the technical craft of it at all. I mean, even for me, the way you use materials, like, I've always used materials, like, wrong. That's not the right word, because there's no wrong way to use something. If you can do it, then it's the right way. But it's, just like, when I paint or something, like, the idea of, like, not using a brush at all, and I paint on, like, plastic sheets and vellum and stuff, and just use weird techniques, or just try to, like, bend what the material can do, or like explore all the potentialities of what this medium can do.
I'm curious so you know how we do workshops here. I'm curious how you would teach a workshop.
I think that actually all the time, because I think, or I see on Instagram all the workshops you do. Mm-hmm. And I've thought so many times, just like, I couldn't do that. I
feel like you could though. I feel like you could. And I feel like people would really want to learn from you, like,
but what would you teach?
Composition.
Yeah, I suppose composition. You could teach kind of. Yeah, I don't know. It would be like trying to teach somebody how to experiment is what it would be, you know? Yeah. Because even when I start, like, a lot of times when people come to me for commissions and certain kind of commissions, and they want to work with me or whatever, they want to have some sort of rigid, like, because they want assurances, right? They're going to pay me to do something. They want certain assurances that something cool is going to come of it, or I'm going to be able to actually do something or whatever. Yeah. But it's really hard for me to give them any assurances because I'm just like, at the beginning of everything, it's all experimental. It doesn't matter what I'm doing. It's experimental, and I'll try different mediums or whatever, but you can't quantify it at all. So yeah, it's just experimenting until I experiment until I see something that excites me, and then you kind of go down that rabbit hole or whatever. So how would you teach somebody to experiment? And then I think you'd also have to teach them how to see, to recognize something, mm-hmm. you know?
But I feel like, I mean, going back to the whole educational system and structure traditionally of things, I feel like that's more important.
Yeah.
To be able to allow yourself to open your mind for self-discovery as opposed to trying to replicate.
Exactly.
That is more important. I think not just in art, but in everything.
Yeah.
I feel totally. Like if we had people that were more self-aware, I mean, and you know, I'm not trying to like say that everyone should be like a creative artist type or whatever, because it's just allowing yourself to be more like yourself. That's just how people can be trust themselves and be happier.
Yeah. As 100%.
People. Yeah.
100%. Nobody wants to replicate like you use. That's a good word. But yeah, artists do that. Yeah. They start just replicating themselves after mm-hmm. a while, you know?
Yeah.
And that's just as dull as any other form of replication, mm-hmm. really.
There's this Bruce Lee quote. I don't know the quote, like, you know, verbatim, but it said something about don't go and try to find a unique personality, replicate it, just be who you are.
Yeah.
You
know? Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of power to that. And I think that's why Bruce Lee, for example, it was such a profound martial artist and philosopher in his own right. And that's why I think a lot of people still, I mean, I think he died when he was like in his late 30s or mid 30s.
Really?
Yeah.
He was that young?
Mm-hmm.
I watched a documentary about him not that long ago. I don't remember it though, really.
Yeah. But
he did get into the philosophy side of things and everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't he? Yeah.
He did. Yeah.
I do think it does go hand in hand with certain like philosophy. If you get into philosophy and shit, you know, like that kind of art practice is really reminiscent of, you know, certain like Eastern philosophies.
Mm-hmm.
I read a shit ton on like Taoism and Zen and Buddhism. Mm-hmm. And I feel like when I started reading on that, I think I started reading a book on Zen by Alan Watts. Was the first thing I read that kind of like was like, whoa. It felt like I was reading something that I already knew all of it. I just didn't, like, I intuitively knew all of it, but I was never able to like vocalize it or anything like that. Yeah. And then once I started reading on those different philosophies, I feel like it really catapulted like my understanding of my own work, you know?
Mm. Or the meaning of it?
Not really the meaning, like, but just like why I work, how I work and shit. Like the whole, like how I jump around and you know, like just experiment at the beginning. And like, it's all about like letting things happen naturally and going with the flow. I mean, they call Taoism, you know, the watercourse way, or that's the name of one of Alan Watts books actually, is Tao, the watercourse way or whatever. But I was talking about like flow and like, you know, you go with the flow. That Taoism is a fucking religion or philosophy, whatever you want to call it, of going with the fucking flow, you know? So if you read those things and you understand those things, you see how it starts to play in with the art practice and they start playing off of each other. And
yeah.
And personally, I don't separate my art practice from like my life, or if that makes sense, where
it's just one in one.
It's
and one,
it's
in the
one
same.
Thing. It's one thing. Like, you know, I'm not, I don't go and do art and then I stop doing art and then my life starts or something. It's like, they're all the same. And like when I'm not drawing or painting, I'm watching a movie or a TV show. But when I'm doing that, I'm still have the same lens that I'm viewing everything through. and gaining the same inspiration that I would as if I were working. Or a lot of times I sit with a notebook when I'm watching TV or movies, and I'll write things down and I'll get titles for pieces, or I'll get ideas or whatever. And same with reading books, reading comic books, listening to podcasts. One of my favorite things to do is just walk for hours and hours and hours. I was just up in Portland and Seattle for, you know, 2 weeks, and almost every day I would just have a Uber drop me off at some faraway point that I had already, you know, decided on. It would be a park or something mostly. But then I would just mostly just spend the entire day walking all the way back, you know, miles and miles. And as I'm doing that, you know, taking pictures and viewing things. And that to me is just as much of an art practice as sitting down to draw. Mm-hmm. So
you're constantly working on yourself. Yeah. You're constantly working on the way that you view the world and your perspective, and like honing in on like how you think. And that, I think that's,
and then the art becomes like the window into that inner world, or into you. That the art's like the window for other people to look into your world or something. If that, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true.
It's like you have, like you cultivate this point of view and this perspective, and it's very robust to yourself, right? It's very fulfilled and robust, and it makes sense to you. But then you have to, then, I mean, you don't have to, but and then I create these things that are a culmination of all that experience and all that, you know, rich inner life, and showing it as windows into that robust world that you've created inside of yourself, or something like that. That sounds really romanticized, but hopefully that makes some sense.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with an explanation that's romanticized, as long as the intention of it is a good intention.
Sure. And as long as it's not like convoluted or you're like delusional about it. You know what I mean? Like, well, people over-romanticize shit, but they're delusional because it's not what they say it is. You know, I see that all the time, or I'll read an artist statement about what this art piece is and just be like,
it wasn't about that.
Yeah, it's not about that at all. Yeah. Like, you just made that up to sound a certain way, to impress a certain person, or make people think that you're a certain way or something, you know?
But that is an interesting social experiment as well. I mean, if you think of it like from your point of view, and then create some sort of statement to see how people will react to it.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of interesting as well, because then it turns into a more social experiment, and it's more of like about that person's point of view towards what you've created.
Sure.
If that makes sense. You know what I mean? But a lot of the time it's not, that's not the intention. It's to make the artist sound much more.
Yeah. It's like essentially just like lying, for lack of a better word there.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
like,
yeah. 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 Exactly.
And I mean, to bring it back to my show that I have coming up, The Drawing Show or whatever, honesty was definitely a huge like tenet of the process, or like what I was thinking about, or like what I wanted, you know, how I wanted this show to be. Or I wanted it to just to look, I wanted it to be really honest. I don't know how to say it, elaborate on that idea of being honest, but I didn't want it to be the show where I had these ideas that I wanted to like portray to people. Like, I didn't want to like put my opinions on the walls, you know. I wanted it to just be more of a direct honesty from like a gut thing, where it's like, blah, here's this. I just threw it on the wall, you know. There's like, blah, me on the wall, without any sort of fancy ideas or coming up with these contrived narratives or anything, you know. It was just more of like a direct honesty, and also like modesty. I wanted it to be a really modest show. Like, originally I wanted the show to be called whatever I was going to title it. I wanted the subtitle to just be like Some Drawings, like, you know, like just really low-key, modest, like, and honest, like just really don't try to over romanticize what this was. Like, this was me buying like 70 sheets of paper and sitting down and kind of driving myself fucking crazy, but drawing on every single one of them, and just like, just almost like spewing it out, you know? In that way, I mean, I think it worked out. It's very honest. And I think that the installation that I'm doing to go along with the show of all this, the black sheets of paper, that, I mean, in a way you could call them failures, because I looked at it, I decided, fuck this, and I painted it black. It's a failed drawing in a way, but at that same time, then I destroyed it and made it into something else, which became the installation. But by showing all the failed drawings on the wall, I don't know how I could be more honest about what this process was.
Yeah.
You know? like the stuff that I deemed good enough that's in frames over here. And that's all the shit that didn't make it.
Yeah. What did you call it?
The show?
Yeah.
Tire Fire.
Tire Fire.
Yeah.
Is there a reason for that?
Is
there a reason why you didn't call it Honest Failures?
Honest Failures? That would have been a great idea too. Yeah. I like that name. Well, I was going to what other names did I have for a while? At one point, I was going to just call it Guh, G-U-H, mm-hmm. As a, like an onomatopoeia, like ugh, or, you know, something like a sound instead of a word as a way of like detaching vocalizing language it. From it. Yeah. Of what did you say?
Vocalizing it.
Yeah. Well, that was kind of the feeling of the show was Guh, something, you know, something like that. But then I thought that was almost too abstract because I told a couple of people that I was singing on that and they would be like, what does that mean? And I was like, never mind.
Yeah. You're like,
have to explain, you know, I didn't want to have to explain that all the time.
Yeah.
Because it totally defeated the purpose.
Yeah. I hate it when people try to over explain their, which is funny because we're talking about just art and,
yeah.
And I feel like maybe.
But when they try to over explain the meaning or.
Yeah, and because, and I guess this, you know, this comes back to that point of intention, right? Of like why you want to lead someone into thinking it's this way, or, you know, like, was it honest, or are you trying to manipulate someone's thought, mm-hmm. right? But yeah, I don't know. Sometimes things, you know, the reason why I'm just going to bring this back to like a music idea. The reason why I like lyrics so much is because there's so much with good lyricists, there's so much poignancy and elegancy with certain people's lyrics, and it's not so verbose, like they don't say too much about, you know, because you can only write so many lyrics, right? Mm-hmm. It's pretty interesting to be able to say something with very little.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And to say something that's gonna like that has soul and meaning to it
without overstating it or something.
I
have a real problem with like music with vocals that the older I get, the more and more problem I have with music with vocals,
because you're more aware of the lyrics,
more aware, and like you just, I mean, I've become aware, like every single thing you hear like seeps into your brain whether or not you're conscious or unconscious of it, and I don't want to listen to motherfuckers' opinions about shit sometimes. Dude. You know, like, and that's what lyrics are a lot of the times. It's like people spreading their, you know, their beliefs and their ideas and their opinions on things, and it doesn't matter if they're right or wrong or useful or destructive. That's seeping into your brain. So like, I mean, I go through long spans of time when I can't listen to lyrical music at all, because I listen to what they're saying and I'll disagree, or I'll just be like, that's just the wrong way of thinking or something, you know?
I know what you mean. Yeah. You just don't agree with it, that point of view.
Yeah. But what you're saying about a good lyricist being able to say a lot with a little, I mean, that's the kind of thing I like. Mm-hmm. Like, I like really abstract lyrics for the most part. It's really hard once I recognized or started listening more intently to the lyrics. I think when I was younger, I didn't even care. It was just sound that went along with the rest of the
sound.
Exactly,
yeah.
Now I hear
like
what they're saying.
Structures and patterns,
yeah, exactly.
Right? You see it for that.
Where the vocals were just another instrument, but now I'm hearing the words that they're saying, and that's not an instrument. That's like subliminal messaging or whatever. It's not even subliminal. It's just messaging. It's what it is.
No, I agree. I mean, as I've been getting older, I've been more aware of like when I'm just sitting there working on my laptop and I'm listening to music as well. Now I have to, detach myself from, or I just have to listen to things without lyrics.
Yeah.
Like I really like Nils Fromm.
Not familiar. Electronic?
He's kind of like a modern day classical pianist.
Oh, I'll have to write that down.
Yeah. And
I'm always looking for that kind of stuff.
Yeah, Nils Fromm. I listen to Eric Satie.
Unfamiliar again.
You might like Eric Satie, but he's an actual like classical pianist composer.
I'm into that. Yeah. That's another thing that's happened over the years is that my taste has just opened up 100%. Where like I don't have any certain kind of music I really don't like anymore. Besides like pop country, you know, that crap. That shit's annoying as fuck.
Yeah, definitely.
But as far as like all kinds of music go, like I like everything, world music, classical, jazz, like I don't care. I listen to all death metal. Like it's all.
No,
everything.
Me too. Yeah. I listen to like all kinds of different music. It just depends on I guess more so the mood and
yeah,
the function
for sure.
And like
yeah.
what I'm doing at that particular time.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Music has become like an art tool to an extent where like I want to make work that looks like this. And I, a lot of the times, don't actually know what it looks like, but I know what it sounds like. I know what I want my work.
Yeah.
I want my work to look like this sound sometimes, you know what I mean? And so like I'll find the right music to put on that will spark that sort of process in my brain or whatever.
What do you find yourself putting on?
It changes depending on what I want to make, like what feeling I want to put into the work. So like when I was working on Tire Fire, like I said, it was kind of this regression, this into like, you know, my past and younger years and stuff. And I found myself listening to a lot of that music then that I was listening to back then.
Yeah.
Like old grunge and punk and old shoegaze and stuff like from the 90s and shit. Like I got back into like Smashing Pumpkins, Adore era shit.
Yeah, I was just listening to Smashing Pumpkins yesterday.
Nice.
And I was like dissecting. I mean, I wasn't like fully dissecting it, like sitting down for
hours. What were you listening to? What album?
I forget which album I was listening. Melancholy? It was just on Spotify.
Okay.
Let me see.
So probably some random shit.
I'm really bad with like album names, first of all. But let me see.
I'm an album guy. I like listening to an album from the beginning to the end. In most days in my studio, because I'll get so into that zone, that album will play on repeat, like 20, 30 times some days, like on a long day, and just repeat, nothing else. Like that's just how I am.
No, I that kind of reminds me of when I was a kid and I would play these like it sounds so stupid, but you know, these computer games like EverQuest,
World of Warcraft,
and they don't have an end. You're just going on forever.
Yeah.
And then I would listen to just certain albums just on repeat, and then when I listen to it now, it just reminds me of that feeling of being a kid.
Yeah,
maybe that's similar to the way that you felt with
Totally
some of this music that you've listened to for the show, right?
For sure. Once I started listening to that, it kind of self-perpetuated, you know, with the artwork where I was like, oh, this is reminding me of when I was younger. Let me listen to the music I listened to when I was younger. And then I started personally finding all those albums that I used to love and listening to them while working, and like this effort to like, I want to draw like that, you know, or whatever, or I want to work from that place. So I'm going to wake up and I'm going to find one of those albums or, and listen to that, like an old Helmet album or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
And then I would draw in that way. But it changed, you know, as I worked, you know, listen to different things based on what I wanted to work on.
Yeah.
Or definitely. Like what I wanted the work to feel like, you know?
Speaking of, just bring it back to the whole good lyricist discussion. Billy Corgan's a fucking amazing lyricist.
It's so funny. I feel like I've talked about Billy Corgan with so many people lately.
Really?
Because I was listening to that Adore album like pretty incessantly for a while. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then me and my friend were trading pictures of Billy Corgan throughout the years. And I was sending the Adore era Billy Corgan, you know, shaved head, black, under his eyes and stuff, you know, like goth era Billy Corgan. Looks so cool. I mean, that's such a cool look.
Yeah.
I love that shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the next picture my friend sent to me was a picture of him like wearing a UFC hoodie and all chubby and shit. And that's what he looks like now.
A UFC hoodie?
He's into fucking MMA and shit, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I actually didn't know that.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't.
No, I don't think there's anything wrong with it. I'm like, that's awesome. Like, and that goes back to what we were just talking about too, of like not pigeonholing yourself and just following, you know, your path and doing what you want to do.
Sure.
I mean, the dude got older and he started liking MMA. Fucking go for it, man. Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Yeah.
What's that? Follow your bliss, right? Eat, pray, love. Whatever the fuck that
definitely.
Shit is.
Definitely. Yeah. No, that's true. I mean, I can empathize with that. I mean, I've always loved martial arts and fighting. And,
yeah, man, you do jujitsu, right?
Well, I did jujitsu for 8 years, and then I bought. Now I just box.
Now you're just doing boxing.
Yeah, but cool. I love that stuff, man. It's just so much.
I think it's amazing.
So much fun.
If I was more of a social person, I would definitely take classes or something.
You don't have to be a social person to
really
do.
Don't you have to like interact with other people?
I mean, I guess so, but I just train my coaches.
Sure.
His private lessons. Or
I want to get some information from you after this. I want to ask, because I want to be like, well, how much does that cost and shit? But you don't have to talk about that now. Yeah. You can tell me later.
No, I mean, he's a really good coach, and he's not.
I would love to do that.
Not
yeah.
expensive.
I would yeah. love to do that.
Yeah.
To get into that sort yeah. of thing. I mean, those are all, to me, those are all different ways of like, oh shit, what am I looking for here? I don't want to say it's like different meditations or whatever, but in the same way that like Zen Buddhists or whatever use archery as a way to explore their philosophy, right?
Exactly.
I see that as that. I mean, yeah. I see when I go play basketball, I'm putting into practice, you know, philosophical ideas on that sort of thing. Like yeah. I read like this book called The Inner Game of Tennis. Have mm-hmm. you heard of that? It's the book that I like basketball. Mm-hmm. I don't pay attention too much to like the organized sport, you know.
Yeah, but
I
just like the basketball Warriors as the
yeah, as a thing. I like the Warriors because of Steve Kerr, who is like, he's like a really Zen dude, and he got that from Phil Jackson when he was on the Bulls, you know?
Okay.
Phil Jackson was a really spiritual, like Zen Buddhist type guy. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know tons about it. I don't know if he was Buddhist or if he just was into more like the Zen side of Zen Buddhism or whatever. But so Steve Kerr got that from him, and then he brought it to the Warriors or whatever. He has them like shoot threes in the dark and shit like that, like intuitive shooting. And
well, that's crazy. That's
but he cool. makes, he makes really all of his, cool. I think Phil Jackson made him read this book called The Inner Game of Tennis, and now he makes all his players read this game, this book. So I read that book, and it was amazing. It was just all about how to like trust your instincts and this intuitive form of play where you don't need to intellectually understand the technicalities of the sport. It's more of a muscle memory instinct, you know,
yeah,
way of playing. And once I read that book, and then I started putting it into practice when I would shoot around, you know, like when I was shooting, I'm not thinking like, okay, elbow straight, follow through, blah, blah, blah. It's more like just put it up in the air and trust yeah. it's going to go in. And just putting it in the air and trusting it's going to go in works so much better than trying to like figure it out, you know, the exact specifications of how to make a shot.
Exactly.
And I think like what we're talking about, boxing can be that same kind of experience. Art making is obviously that kind of experience for me, because that's exactly what I was talking yeah. about earlier, the whole starting with an experiment and following your intuition through it. It's all that kind of thing. So I'm really interested in those kind of practice. That's why I would love to hear this information about your trainer.
Yeah. That's the thing is like, so I've had a lot of coaches over the years, and this coach in particular, I think the technical side informs the more philosophical side of like the, of,
well, you definitely need a yeah. ground. You need that ground,
exactly.
and then you can build up from there. Whatever.
Yeah.
So like yeah. going back to the basketball reference, if I didn't have a single clue how to shoot a basketball, just throwing it in the air and hoping it's going to go in is not a good way to figure out how to play basketball, right?
Yeah.
So I know what you're saying. Yeah, absolutely. You do have to have some sort of like technical know-how or whatever. And then yeah. same with art. I mean, yeah, obviously I there's certain things I had to learn, you know, to be able to have this sort of practice, but
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I think it's there's a balance there, but with my coach in particular, he's been really trying to hone in on what works for me because I move a certain way.
Yeah, I'm sure then, everybody does.
Yeah, yeah.
So a good coach would recognize that and push you
yeah.
towards what's best for you, not like just what's best for everybody.
Exactly.
And that kind of goes back to like that idea of the workshops too. Like, I don't know, you know, how to, you can only teach a craft because of that. Because with a class like that, you're not going around to each individual, getting to know them, getting to know how they work best and blah, you know, and then guiding them along the way like that. It's more of like a generalized thing.
Yeah, then maybe more that's like a one-on-one private like seminar or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah. Seminar on trust, like learning to trust your intuition or something, you know?
But those conversations are very important, and I think that they could be facilitated to people, you know, those like more one-on-one approaches.
Sure, yeah, yeah. Yeah, well, I'm going to get that information from you.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds good.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
But
we never got went off on a tangent here. You asked me what tire fire meant, and I just we talked about
it. It's okay. No,
about that.
The tangents occur, and I think that's totally fine.
No, it's totally fine. I just thought it was funny. I was like, how did we start talking about this? And that was that.
Yeah. I guess, yeah, we can end it with, if you want to explain a little bit more about the show.
Well, the name Tire Fire, which is what you asked in the first place, it's kind of an amalgamation of a bunch of different ideas that when I thought of it as the, like, it's a phrase that has been in my mind for a long time. It felt really natural. Like, I think it's probably just because of how it rolls off the tongue. I mean, they're almost the same word, you know, tire fire. But it's always been there. And then when I thought of it as the name, I'm like, oh shit, that's perfect. But I think it started a while back because there was a recycling plant or something around where I live over in the industrial area, you know, that overnight had lit on fire. Like there was a big fire and it would create an overcast and it smelled like burning tire. It smelled like burning rubber. And I just remember thinking, like, I've always loved that smell for some reason. I think it's probably because my dad was a mechanic and I always was in the garage smelling the grease and the rubber and all that shit, those, whatever those smells are. And I remember smelling in the air and being like, this is, I like this actually, but what a weird thing to like, because it's normally considered like a putrid smell, right? You know, people don't want to smell it. And then I started thinking about how, like, you know, there's what a weird, perverse little part of me that is that likes that. Because at the same time, I don't like it, but I do like it, but I also don't like it. And so when I thought of the name for the show, it was like, yeah, I like that a lot because it's kind of speaking towards that perverse part of myself that likes the smell of burning rubber.
Yeah.
And likes being around scrap yards and just that gnarly industrial shit. So it spoke kind of towards that. And I also like that when I hear tire fire, the first thing I think of is burning rubber. And then the smell comes to mind. So it's kind of a olfactory sense, bringing that into the meaning, which, I mean, I've never once considered smell when thinking about art. So just that in itself was a cool thing. So that's part of it. Also, if you look up the definition of tire fire on Wikipedia, it says like a tire fire takes place where tires are stored or recycled or whatever. And there's like two kinds of tire fires. One is one that just like burns out super quick. It's like super like violent fire and burns out super quick. And then there's this other kind of tire fire that can last for decades where it's like there's a bunch of tires. I think the word is a self-rolling or self-perpetrating, self-whatever, pyrolysis. And I don't know the exact definition of that, but I think it, but what it is, it's like when the chemical compounds start to, like, it's almost like spontaneous combustion, right? Where it's like this slow burn within the compounds of the tires, and those can last for decades, it said. And I was just fascinated by that, like, holy shit. Like, so this idea of like a fire that can burn out super fast, or this fire that just is like this slow burn forever. And then the definition ends with something like they're notably difficult to put out. They're notably, you know, one of the more difficult fires to put out. And I was just like, well, that's just a metaphor for like fucking life, right? Like everybody's life or whatever. But kind of the thought that I was having was like, yeah, like, you know, that's where I make art from, that tire fire inside. We all got that tire fire inside, right? That slow burning fuel that just keeps you going, you know, through all the crazy, terrible tragedies and shit, you know, it just burns on and you just keep on burning and burning, going and adapting. And yeah, I just really like that metaphor. It felt like a metaphor that didn't need to even be explained. You can just read that definition and it's kind of like, oh yeah, I get it. You know, it makes sense.
Yeah, I like that you gave the explanation though. I think, yeah, there's definitely an eloquency to the thought of creating that name, and also a remembrance of things of the past for you.
Yeah.
Personally.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I really wanted to, I've never been very forthcoming about like who I am personally with my art or even in interviews and stuff, only until recently, I guess, you know, but I wanted people to start having some sort of, or at least with my art, to start showing some of my background or like where I came from type thing. I think for a long time I was just embarrassed of where I came from. Because I'm from, you know, I'm from a town in Wisconsin that was like, the population when I lived there was like right around 1,000 people only. It was tiny, and I was surrounded by farms, and it was a farming community, and I was always embarrassed of that. I'm like, artists don't come from that. I'm so uneducated. I didn't go to a museum until I was like fucking 18 years old. Like, yeah. I felt so embarrassed and almost ashamed or something of that. But now I'm proud of it in a way. I'm like, I like it, or I'm comfortable at least exploring it, and I'm finding a lot of inspiration from it. Particularly the whole mechanic side of things. Like, there's a Draxler service in Wisconsin that's my dad's side of the family owns, but that's where my dad worked as a kid, you know, and he was always working on cars and trucks in our garage, and I was always around it, and I never really brought that side into my artwork, even though it inspired me very much. It just was never obvious, I don't think, in the work or whatever, but I've noticed that every city I live in, I always end up having like a studio in the most industrial, gnarly scrap yards and shit, you know,
yeah,
trucking shit. I'm always in those area of towns. I'm always taking pictures of car wrecks, or like, you know, piles of tires and just junkyards and scrap and stuff like that. Yeah. And I think I just wanted to bring it more to the forefront with a name like that, with Tire Fire, I think.
Yeah.
Getting to that a little bit. And also, ire means anger. So if you take the T and the F, it's anger, which is also funny.
Yeah, there's a lot of meaning.
There's tons. So I can't really pinpoint it to just one, because what really happened was that I had that other name that we talked about earlier, and then I realized it didn't really do what I wanted it to do. And then when I landed on Tire Fire, it just almost seemed obvious, and it kind of just went with it, and then it unfolded all the different meanings that it has, you know. It was a very intuitive thing deciding on that name. It just kind of like struck me and was just like, that's it. I don't need to like justify that to myself. Mm-hmm. And then over time, yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like the more that we allow ourselves as artists to just organically create, the meaning will come. The meaning is already there, whether we're conscious of it or not. And the more that we question it, then we become more conscious of it and can verbalize it and structure it into like a more tangible explanation.
Sure.
For the outside. Yeah. Right? But
I like how you say that, though, how you said that the meaning is there regardless on if you're aware of it or not. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like that idea because it's true.
Yeah.
You don't have to conceptualize a whole bunch at the beginning before doing something, which I think is a misconception when a lot of people start out with art, that they feel that they have to have an idea of what they're doing before they start doing it. Mm-hmm. And I think at the beginning it might be hard to not have that idea before starting, but yeah, it's a misconception for sure. Like life in general to me, it's about action, you know. Do it. Like, don't fucking think in there. Don't just sit around and talk about doing something or thinking about doing something. Just do it when you feel it, you know. Mm-hmm. There's a, I think his name's Joseph Campbell, right? I always get it screwed up.
Yeah, Joseph Campbell.
The 10 rules or whatever for students and teachers.
I don't know. Did Joseph Campbell write that?
He co-wrote it or something, or like his teacher wrote it, but he was like, a teacher wrote it, but then gave him partial credit for it because he helped develop it. It's something. I'm not exactly sure.
Okay.
But I think it's like the eighth rule, or one of the rules is, it's like, do not make and analyze at the same time. There are two different processes. And that I remember hearing that a long time ago, and it always stuck with me, you know, because I think probably back then when I was starting out, I probably had troubles with that too, where I was looking for meaning, like, what does this mean? Like, how do I justify the existence of this artwork that I made? You know, like, you're looking to justify why you did that. Mm-hmm. At least for me, I was trying to either think of it that beforehand or while I was working, and it gets in the way. It's like you're tripping over your own feet in that instance, right? Because you're trying to create and analyze at the same time. But those are like the quote says, those are different processes. They're very using different parts of your brain even. So one can impede on the other, I think, if you're trying to do them at the same time. Exactly. So yeah, it's like, just do the shit, just do it and think and worry about it later. Worry about what you did later, you know. You don't have to justify everything you do or have a reason for everything.
Yeah.
You know. And that wasn't that what Dada was, even like a response even to that whole idea, because Dadaist was like absurdity. It was the whole idea that you don't need a reason. There doesn't need to be a reason for everything. You know, you don't have to understand everything.
Yeah.
You know, things can just be what they are, which is another that goes back to like Zen Buddhism and Taoism as well, where, you know, there's a concept of just isness, where like you boil anything down to a certain point, you just kind of got to end with like, it just is, because we don't have the answer at you know, at the core of everything. We don't know everything. So at some point with almost everything, you just have to accept a certain amount of isness. Just is, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I think a lot of people just want to dissect and try to understand. And I think, you know, it's you go back and forth. You try to think why you do something and then try to understand it and then go and do it. And then, I mean, I think the process is, it will never end, but I do agree you can't do both at the same time.
Yeah.
Like as you're creating, you're analyzing, because then you might sit there at one piece of artwork for years.
Yeah.
If you just continue, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I found myself being really stuck when I started making this podcast, which is, this is my investigation into the minds of other artists, right? I was just so lost. I
like with your own art practice?
Yeah, I was just so lost. I was just like, what the fuck am I doing?
And you felt that way at the beginning when you started doing this podcast? Was that the inspiration for the podcast,
that
would
was
you say?
Partial inspiration.
Yeah?
Yeah. I was just like, dude, I don't know what I'm doing. Like, I don't know. I feel like I'm creating from an unauthentic place. I felt like I was a fraud or something.
That's the worst, right?
Yeah.
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 Imposter syndrome.
Yeah, imposter syndrome.
Have you heard of that?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So
I feel that all the time.
I think everyone that's creating... I mean, I don't want to be reductive about the thought of it, but everyone that's an artist thinks that sometimes.
I think so.
Yeah.
I don't think it's always such a bad thing.
Yeah.
I mean, I think maybe in a way, the idea of imposter syndrome as like an actual like syndrome or thing or whatever, that's a negative thing. But questioning yourself and... going through those periods of like hating your work or thinking like you're not good enough or whatever, it keeps, I mean, at least for me, it keeps me in check. It keeps me modest for sure.
Yeah.
You know, once it's too, it gets to be too much where, you know, it becomes
neurotic.
Yeah. It becomes neurotic. Exactly. Yeah. And then it's dangerous. I think, you know, very bad thing. And I know that I paralyzed myself, with those thoughts when I was doing this, working on this show a lot, because it's been so long since I drew or whatever. Like, so I kept on having the thought of, why the fuck do I deserve this show? Like, why am I doing this? Like, what, like, I'm not a drawer. But that's bullshit. I am. I'm fucking drawing. I'm a drawer. But I just was like, there are people who dedicate their entire career to just drawing or whatever. And then, so I felt like I was just like ghosting in on this drawing shit and having my own solo show of it. And I definitely felt that imposter syndrome a lot. And I went through a phase of comparing my shit to other people's, which is just the most heinous, awful shit. Like,
it's such a human thing, though.
It is. It's just so terrible, though. Like, with Instagram and shit, like, you know, I would draw for a little bit, and then I would go on Instagram, and I would page through, and then I would see everybody else's work, and that's so many times, I'd just be like, it would make me stop looking at other people's work. I would have to stop, because I would get so, like, repulsed with myself, almost, or like, why am I even doing this? That person's better, or whatever, you know? But it's not even about that you lose sight of that. I lost sight of that, at least, like, lose sight of why you're doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
When you're constantly comparing yourself to what other people are doing.
Exactly. You just, like you said, you just paralyze yourself.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You go in this self paralysis and this like self loathing process.
Absolutely. And you're doing it to yourself. Like there's literally nobody else involved in that.
Yeah.
Then when you realize that, it feels foolish and it's weird, but like I was saying, I think that it keeps me modest to a degree, and then at times makes me feel like absolute garbage. But that's a problem that I definitely ran into with the drawing, with this show, and it probably will show in some of the work too. You know, like, and that's fine. That's part of the honesty of it. You know, I'm totally cool with that. It's easier for me when I'm doing my other work because there's not a lot of people doing what I do with like the other mediums and shit, right? Mm-hmm. Like the way that I paint is more like a printmaker or like a monotype maker than it is like what people do on canvas or whatever. And the way that I collage or do large scale stuff, it's different than other how other people do it. So when I'm working in those mediums, I don't feel this comparative nature to it because they're like, they're staying similar, but not to the degree or, you know, I feel like I built up my collage process from scratch. I wasn't really looking at the way anybody else was doing anything. It's just kind of like, this is how I do it. And now I've been doing it so long that it's like, I can't compare it to anybody else's. So
yeah,
you don't run into that.
Yeah, you definitely have a very distinct point of view on that.
So like when I picked up drawing, I was like, oh shit, tons of people draw. So it was a whole different animal, you know, to overcome that imposter syndrome that I haven't really felt in a long time.
Yeah. That's cool. I think that's, you'd open up another chapter.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, it's been such a great, it was a really great experience. And especially like even in doing so, you know, I have a spotty past, you know, but even when I was working, I remember I called my dad to ask him like certain questions about my childhood and stuff, like didn't really have a direct relation to the art I was making besides that these are what I was thinking about. And this was, you know, where the process brought me. So I was really exploring my past and coming to terms with certain things and everything. It was really positive. And I found a new love for drawing all over again, for sure. And I'll definitely keep up with drawing now. I'll add it to that rotation I was talking about earlier, whereas before drawing was a very minimal part of that process or that cycle of things. But now it'll be another one, collaging, doing the panels, painting, drawing, just going through the cycle.
Just open yourself up to
open myself up to that again. Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
So I'm really happy with the show, which sounds so weird to say because at one point I was absolutely disgusted by it.
Yeah.
But I'm happy with it.
Yeah.
I am. I'm curious to see what people's reactions to it will be because I've only shared a very small bits of it and stuff. So it's going to be interesting. It'll be interesting to see it up in the gallery and shit. So yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
Wish I could be out there to see it. When is it?
It's up in July 8th until August 12th.
Oh, damn. Because I'm going to be in New York.
Oh, really?
August 17th, I think.
Well, go to the gallery anyways.
Yeah.
Because the work will still be there.
Okay.
I'll talk to Casey and tell him that you want to swing through or whatever. I'm sure he'll love to talk to you too.
Yeah.
Because Justin, who you do, for all the listeners, Justin Hopkins, who you do No Wave with or whatever, he's showing at Booth Gallery shortly after me, right? Mm-hmm. With Emilio and somebody else.
Yeah.
Seagrove?
I don't know. I don't know Justin's plans all the time. Well, even though I spend like almost every single day with the guy. But yeah, I know.
Yeah, there's a three-person show coming up there or whatever. So
that's true. Oh, no, but that's going to be a while from now. I think
it's
in 2018.
Oh, I thought that was like October.
Of 2018, I think.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Never mind.
Well, yeah.
But either way, it definitely seems that
there's a connection there.
Yeah. So like the crowd that you guys are cultivating with No Wave, definitely there's a Venn diagram happening with what the programming at Booth and Last Rites is, mostly Booth. So it would be a great connection for you to meet Casey anyways. So
might be interesting to talk to or bring him on the podcast.
I bet you he would love to do it.
Yeah.
He would love to do it. Have you had a curator on here before? Or
I've had one.
Really?
Unit London.
Oh, who?
Joe Kennedy.
Okay, no.
Yeah.
That's cool. Were you in London when you did it?
No, we just did it over Skype.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's cool. Mm-hmm. What a different take on it. So you've had musicians?
Musicians, a couple curators, martial artists.
A couple what?
Martial artists.
Martial artists.
I had Eddie Bravo.
You had Eddie Bravo on here?
Yeah. It's grown since the beginning, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Eddie Bravo. He's on Joe, right?
Yeah.
He's on Joe Rogan all the time.
Yeah.
People will probably hate me for saying this. Ah, fuck it. I'm going to say it. I love that Joe Rogan episode with Alex Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck, that episode is amazing.
I have not listened to it.
They get him drunk and stoned and it's just...
That's awesome.
It's a fucking trip.
Yeah.
It's a fucking head trip. Mm-hmm. But Eddie Bravo is on that too and he gets pretty geeked out.
I know. Yeah. I made sure Hannah actually is the one, Hannah Vandermeer.
Yeah, yeah.
She was on that episode, and she introduced me to Eddie, and we made sure not to go down that rabbit hole of like Pizzagate and like, you know,
yeah, Pizzagate,
and
bro,
all that shit. Yeah, made sure not to go down that rabbit hole because
yeah,
that was a
what's his other
rabbit hole?
I'm not going to be able to remember, but he's into like conspiracy theory big time, right? Isn't
yeah,
he? Like mm-hmm. Yeah, I know Pizzagate was one of them, but he's like even like aliens and shit, right? This
yeah, we I
Alex Jones talking about interdimensional reptilian whatever coming through and like that. Oh God, it's so entertaining.
It's a very strange thought. I'll have to listen to that episode. I've heard that episode getting brought up a lot.
It's so good.
Yeah,
I mean not good in the way like you know Alex Jones is fucking out of his mind and mm-hmm. he has a lot of faults. That's for sure. Yeah. But man, was it? And it's an entertaining,
yeah.
Listen, it's like 3.5 hours long.
Well, that's like all of Joe Rogan's
podcasts. Yeah, I know they're yeah. so long.
The one that I listened to of Joe Rogan's that I really liked is the one with Henry Rollins.
Yeah,
and then they're talking about traveling.
Wonderful episode.
Yeah,
I felt
he's like a reform. I feel like they're both like reform, like ultra manly dudes.
Sure.
That
yeah.
have went on this spiritual journey yeah. and come out
both,
on the other
you
side.
You mean like both Joe Rogan and
Joe yeah, and Henry absolutely. Rollins, you know?
Yeah. I was not like,
yeah.
I know a lot of people who know a lot about Henry Rollins or like have read his books, like Get in the Van and shit like that. And I don't have any background really with Henry Rollins besides some of his music.
Yeah.
But when I listened to that episode, that was definitely not what I was expecting. And I found so many similarities between like that like myself and him.
Yeah.
The way that he talked about certain things, I was just like, holy shit.
Yeah,
you know,
me too.
I feel like I'm not so crazy for feeling the same way about certain things. Like when he said that thing about somebody will call him and he'll see and he'll be like, what the fuck? I thought this person liked me. Why are they calling? You know, I feel that same way all the time. Like I hate talking on the phone too. And people give me shit about it. It makes me feel like what's wrong with me that I just like, I'd rather not talk to people most of the time. I'd rather be alone most of the time.
Yeah.
And
that's just how
you get,
are.
But you get made to feel like something's wrong with you then because that's not the social norm or that's not yeah. the consensus mm-hmm. Norm. But yeah, I've been hearing him. I was like, exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm the same way. Or yeah. like how he said he'll see a friend of his like on the sidewalk across the way and he said something like, and that's good enough for me. He's like, I'm glad I saw him, but I don't have to say hi or wave. Or...
yeah, <that's laughs>
and
funny.
I've actually done that. Like I've been like, I think I've been yeah. this far away from people at concerts that I know decently well, mm-hmm. but I'll have my hood up and my hat on down or whatever, and I won't say anything to them. I won't yeah. talk to them. I'll stand like feet away from them for a whole yeah, show, yeah. but I won't say anything to them. And...
But I think the people that really know you,
yeah,
they'll accept you for who you
yeah,
are.
Yeah, definitely. 100%.
You know, like, I'm gonna bring up a personal story about you.
Oh no! Oh no!
And you can let me know if you want me to take it out of the episode.
From who?
No! From
oh, that you know
me.
Oh shit! Okay,
you were at one of the openings, and then you like I was like, hey, what's up, man? And then our photographer came over and was gonna take a photo of us, and he flipped him off. And then in my head, this is all gonna relate. In my head, I was just like, "Oh, that's just Jesse being drunk, Jesse, right now," you know. So I just gave you a pass,
sure.
And then I explained to the photographer, I was like, "Oh, dude, don't worry about it. He was just
well, but they were offended that I flipped off the camera.
No, they're offended. Yeah, because yeah, they're offended, but." It's all good. Yeah.
It was of course just it's all good. Yeah. Well, I don't like openings.
But
at
I guess
all.
Yeah. But I guess what I'm trying to say is like because I know you
yeah.
relatively well.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, oh dude, Jesse's just
yeah.
He's just, you know, I know that you don't like openings.
And I really hate photos.
Yeah. So I recorded that that processed through my brain as you were doing that, and then I was just like I gave you a pass in my head. I was like, you know, Jesse's not being an asshole. He's just,
I don't know. It was probably a good photo.
Whatever.
What's wrong with that? Isn't that like a photo norm? Flipping the bird,
yeah.
right? Isn't that
yeah,
just
yeah,
like
yeah.
what people do?
But you know, the guy doesn't know you
yeah.
and like you're flipping him off basically.
Yeah.
But anyways, I'm just using that as an example. Like,
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm surprised I didn't just turn around. I mean, I've been at so many openings when they try to take pictures and I'll just turn my back. You know, yeah, I'll be with like three people or four people and I'll just turn around. Like,
yeah.
You know, I don't care.
Yeah.
That stuff doesn't, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so nobody go to my opening, please.
That's why we're releasing it after.
After. Well, I think over time, too, this is pretty unrelated, but I know when I was younger and I would have shows, I put a lot of focus on the opening for some reason. Like, that was the thing. Like, the opening was the show. And now I'm the opposite. Like, you don't even have to have an opening as far as I'm concerned. Like, don't have an opening event. Like, I don't, for my shows, like, I'll go to other people's openings. Obviously, I come to the No Wave shows and stuff. But as far as my work is concerned, if I'm doing a solo show, like, we don't have to have an opening. Just have it up and we can tell people to go to it.
Why is that? On their convenience. Why do you not like that?
I don't know. It's just like, it's like pressure.
Oh,
I don't,
because you get the spotlight.
Yeah, I hate being the center of attention. I don't know. But I hate being the center of attention. I hate small talk. I hate and I mean, I don't like using the word hate. I strongly dislike small talk, and I strongly dislike trying to find a conversational groove with a stranger, or like that awkward, like, we said hello and now what? Like, now what do we, like, what are we supposed to?
Yeah. You know, what's funny is me and you are totally different on that end. Cause I feel like I can, I don't know, maybe just like.
You can just talk forever. I mean, you're the one with the fucking podcast.
That makes sense. I guess so. That would make sense. Yeah.
If I had to weekly have like this kind of conversation, it would be crazy.
But at the same time, I get myself caught in a lot of like awkward conversation because I'm too friendly to people.
Sure.
And like, you know, I'll get in an Uber and then we'll have like a conversation all the way to the airport about some shit that I really don't care about. But then I keep it going just because I feel like I need to for some reason. So I don't know.
I understand.
It could be a character flaw too.
No, I mean,
you know,
that's probably less of a character flaw. But I know what you mean about Ubers for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the thing is, like, I feel more comfortable in an Uber conversation than I would at an opening, like my own opening, for sure.
I see.
Like, definitely. But yeah, I hate small talk and I hate just trying to find conversational flow and stuff. I'd rather just not do it. As far as like your show, you're like, why is that about not needing an opening or whatever? It's because the artwork's not about a party where people get drunk or anything, you know? It's. Mm-hmm. I'm much more interested in somebody who would just stumble across it or hear this podcast and then go look at it and spend time when they have time on their own time and experiencing it that way.
You know,
openings obviously are not the best way to experience the artwork in a show.
Sometimes you can't even see. There's so many people. You can't see the,
So people who want to see the artwork, but they only go to the opening, they're not really even getting, you know, the full experience of the work.
Yeah,
so,
it's more like a social
event. So over time, it just, I have learned, like, I don't really promote openings. Like, I'll promote the show. It's running this time to this time. And you can go whenever you feel like it, if you feel like it. Mm-hmm. But as far as openings are concerned, they're inconsequential. And I mean, I've never even, well, I don't think I've sold work at an opening before. Mm-hmm. I think that's a pretty rare thing that happens. Mm-hmm. And if people are really chomping at the bit to get your work, they already have the collector's PDF before the show is even open. So you sell the work before the opening. So really, what is an opening? It's a social event, and I'm not a huge fan of social events.
Yeah.
So
I see what you mean.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm happy not having an opening.
Well, I guess let's end it on some advice for for people.
Advice for people.
I don't know. I generally ask, you know, about like if you have any advice for people that are starting an art practice. I think I probably asked you on that.
Did you last time? Last time I probably just said like, don't stop believing or something.
And then we ended on the Journey song.
Oh God, don't do that this time. So you're saying advice for what? Advice for somebody?
For people who want to do something creative and an artistic practice as like a career path.
Don't think about it too much. action trumps, you know, any sort of like pre-planning or whatever. So just do shit. That's would be my advice or whatever. I get a lot of people reaching out on Instagram. I always bring up Instagram, I know, but I've deleted all my other social shit besides Twitter, but Twitter's not really for art. So most of my interaction or questions that come in from people who follow my work is through Instagram. But I get a lot of people who will ask me just like the weirdest things about like technical things and whatnot, but I never respond to those. Like I don't have any advice for anybody on how to do what they want to do. I mean, really the only advice there is to just fucking do shit. Just do shit and see what you like and what feels good. And do that. And that's easy as that, I think. And as long as you're following and be honest with yourself, going back to what you're saying about me wanting the show to be really honest, be honest with yourself and what you're doing and in both process, like don't try to overextend past your ability or have these grandiose ideas going into things of what you're going to do. Try not to have any ideas at all of what you're going to do or whatever, you know. But I think being honest with yourself is really important, because if you're not being honest with yourself from like the very get-go or why you're doing this, you know, it's if it's not based on that, then it's going to be false and it's going to look like that to everybody that sees it, you know. So make sure you're pulling from the most honest place you got and following, and I guess that goes hand in hand too with doing what feels good. Be honest about what feels good. Like if you really want to be like a perfect drawer and like draw really well, but you try doing it and it doesn't really work out, don't do it. Do something else, you know. I remember I tweeted something like a riff on the whole like, if you fail, try again. That whole like, what is it? Try again, or what? How does it go? The common phrase of like, if you fail first time, try again. Try. Do you know what I'm talking about?
No, I don't know, actually.
I think it's a common phrase or something, you know. If at first you don't succeed, try again type thing. It's the gist of it or whatever. But I was like, if you try and don't succeed, try fucking something else. You know, try something else. I think that's more of a practical advice instead of like trying to, because maybe not everybody can do what they feel like they should do, but what they feel they should do
isn't what they should do.
Isn't necessarily what they do. Yeah. That's their intellect and not, you know, their intuition.
Yeah.
And you should always follow your intuition, not your intellect. So if you think you want to be a drawer, but you suck at drawing, try painting. And if you aren't good at painting, then try something else. Try collaging, you know, installation, try sculpture or photography or just walking around and looking at shit. You know, not everybody's cut out to do everything. So I guess that would be my advice if you're starting out trying to have an art practice.
Yeah.
Be honest with yourself and leave expectations, you know, set expectation aside and be true to yourself.
Cool.
And play around.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah. Cool.
Very cool.
All right. Oh, yeah. Tire Fire, July 8th, August 12th, Booth Gallery in Manhattan, New York City. The end.
Go to the opening.
I don't think there is an opening.
All right. We'll end it there.